We have four major mechanisms that cause edema. It's increased capillary hydrostatic pressure, decreased plasma oncotic pressure, enhanced hydraulic permeability of the capillary walls, and lymphatic obstruction. So here we will try to understand which conditions cause such alterations and how these alterations cause edema. Cardiovascular system is a closed system where fluid exchange occurs in capillaries because capillaries have pores. So we have arterial circulation that delivers blood to capillaries, we have veins that provide outflow of blood from capillaries, and we have capillaries that have pores. Through these pores and capillaries, fluid with nutrients can enter to the interstitial space. From the interstitium, cells that compose a particular tissue receive vital substances. But some portion of fluid after this remains in the interstitium, and then lymphatic system drains the excess fluid from the interstitial space into the venous system. So it's a general picture. The amount of fluid that crosses capillaries and enters to the interstitium depends on filtration rate. And filtration rate is described by Starling equation. Filtration rate is equal to hydrostatic pressure difference between capillaries and interstitium minus oncotic pressure difference between capillary and interstitium, and directly proportional to hydraulic conductivity. It's a simplified version of equation because values as oncotic reflection coefficient and surface area usually are constant, so they are determined mostly by the properties of a particular tissue. First of all, we see that hydrostatic pressure difference is the main driving force that pushes fluid out of the capillary. Oncotic pressure difference is the force that keeps fluid inside the capillary. And hydraulic conductivity, in fact, just describes how permeable is the membrane. So let's begin with the main driving force, which is hydrostatic pressure. We can imagine hydrostatic pressure like this. So hydrostatic pressure is the force that pushes fluid out of the capillary into the interstitial space. To understand what is hydrostatic pressure, we have to recall that hydrostatic pressure is basically a weight of fluid that acts on a particular area. And weight of fluid equals to mass of fluid times gravity constant. In turn, mass of fluid equals to fluid density times fluid volume. So basically the major idea here is that the higher the volume of fluid, the higher is the hydrostatic pressure of fluid. So the higher will be the volume of fluid in the capillaries, the higher will be hydrostatic pressure inside the capillary, and the higher the hydrostatic pressure inside the capillary, the higher the filtration rate. Let's assume that hydrostatic pressure in the interstitial space remains constant. So the major factor here is hydrostatic pressure of fluid in the capillaries. Which factors can cause increase in fluid volume inside the capillary? First of all, it's fluid overload. The two most common conditions that cause fluid overload is chronic heart failure and renal failure. In cardiac disease, because left ventricle cannot deliver enough amount of blood to the kidneys, more fluid will remain in the circulation. And in renal failure, organism simply cannot excrete enough amount of fluid from the organism. In both cases, it will cause increase in plasma volume. Obviously, the higher the total volume of fluid in the cardiovascular system, the higher will be the volume of fluid in the capillaries. So the higher will be the capillary hydrostatic pressure. The higher the capillary hydrostatic pressure, the higher will be the filtration rate, so the larger volume of fluid will income to the interstitial space. Initially, lymphatic vessels will remove all excess fluid from the interstitial space. But the more severe becomes the heart failure or renal failure, the higher will be the plasma volume, the higher will be the hydrostatic pressure inside the capillaries, thereby the higher volume of fluid will income to the interstitial space. And at some point, fluid income from the capillaries to the interstitial space will be higher than lymphatic drainage from the interstitial space. So fluid will accumulate in the interstitium, and accumulation of fluid in the interstitial space causes edema. The second factor that can cause increase in capillary hydrostatic pressure is decrease in venous outflow. It can be caused by venous thrombosis, a compression of the venous vessel by tumor mass, or in case of congestive heart failure or constrictive pericarditis, it can be caused by impaired venous return. So let's take the most common example, which is venous thrombosis. So some fluid from the capillaries income to the interstitial space, but the majority of fluid income to the veins. And the logic here is that if thrombus in venous circulation is formed, it will cause obstruction of the vein. And with obstruction, flow through the venous circulation decreases. Because recall that flow equals to pressure difference divided on resistance. And resistance is inversely proportional to the force power of radius. So if thrombus is formed, it will cause obstruction of the blood vessel. Thereby, radius of the vessel will decrease. With decrease in radius, resistance increase. And with increase in resistance, flow through this region will decrease. So with formation of a thrombus, less volume of blood will flow into the vein. But the amount of blood that is delivered by the arteries remains the same, because nothing wrong with cardiac output. So blood inflow to capillaries becomes higher than blood outflow. Thereby, with decreasing flow in the veins, the volume of blood in capillaries will increase. And with increase in volume, hydrostatic pressure increases. The higher the capillary hydrostatic pressure, the more fluid will income to the interstitial space. And at some point, fluid income to the interstitial space will be higher than lymphatic drainage, so fluid will progressively accumulate in the interstitium, and the accumulation of fluid in the interstitial space will cause edema. The second factor that determines filtration rate is the difference in oncotic pressure between capillary and interstitial space. Let's suppose that oncotic pressure in the interstitium remains constant. Capillary oncotic pressure is a force that keeps fluid inside the capillary. Oncotic pressure is formed by proteins, mostly albumins, and the major concept here is that proteins are osmotically active substances, and because of this, they attract fluid and keep fluid around them. Thereby, they do not let fluid leave intracapillary space. So the idea here is that proteins very like fluid, and they are greedy, they do not want to share fluid with anyone else. And because the concentration of proteins in the circulation is higher than in the interstitial space, proteins keep fluid in the blood circulation. And we have some disorders that cause decreasing amount of proteins in the blood. It's malnutrition, malabsorption, liver failure, and nephrotic syndrome. All of them decrease the amount of proteins in the circulation. So all of them decrease oncotic pressure inside the capillary. And with decreasing oncotic pressure difference, filtration rate increases. So the more fluid will income to the interstitial space. To explain this, there are proteins in the blood circulation and proteins keep fluid around them. First of all, with malnutrition or malabsorption, there is decrease in components from which proteins can be produced. And in cirrhosis, for example, protein synthesis itself decreases. In both cases, the concentration of proteins in the blood will decrease. In nephrotic syndrome, proteins are lost with urine, so the less amount of proteins will remain in the blood. The main idea here is that in both disorders, with decreasing amount of proteins in the circulation, oncotic pressure in the blood and thereby inside the capillary will decrease. And with decreasing capillary oncotic pressure, filtration rate will increase. Because now, without proteins, nothing keeps fluid inside the circulation. Fluid just goes by hydrostatic pressure difference into the interstitial space. Thereby, more fluid will income to the interstitial space. And at some point, fluid income from the capillaries to the interstitial space will be higher than lymphatic drainage from the interstitial space. So fluid will accumulate in the interstitium, and accumulation of fluid in the interstitial space will cause edema. The third factor that determines filtration rate is hydraulic conductivity. Basically, this factor describes how easily fluid moves through the membrane. Two most common factors that affect hydraulic conductivity are inflammation and dilation of pores in capillary. So let's take the most common factor, which is inflammation. Inflammation causes damage to the membrane, and the more damaged is the membrane, the higher will be the fluid flow through this membrane, or we can say the higher will be hydraulic conductivity. And the higher the hydraulic conductivity, the greater amount of fluid will income to the interstitial space. And at some point, fluid income to the interstitial space will be higher than lymphatic drainage. So fluid will accumulate in the interstitium, and accumulation of fluid in the interstitial space will cause edema. The huge factor that determines will edema develops or not is lymphatic drainage. The concept is that the lower is lymphatic drainage, the lesser is the ability of tissue to get rid of excess fluid. The most common conditions that disrupt lymphatic drainage are infections as filariasis, malignancy, or congenital abnormalities. So, for example, if malignancy develops, tumor will cause compression of lymphatic vessel. As we know, fluid flow equals to pressure difference divided on resistance, and resistance is inversely proportional to the force power of radius. So with decrease in radius of lymphatic vessel, resistance decreases, and with increase in resistance, fluid flow through lymphatic vessel will decrease. So lymphatic drainage becomes disrupted, but fluid still income to the capillaries. So now fluid income to the capillaries will be higher than fluid outflow through lymphatic vessel. As a result, fluid will progressively accumulate in the interstitial space, and accumulation of fluid in the interstitium causes edema. Also interesting that some tissues naturally have poorly developed lymphatic drainage. For example, because periorbital tissue has poorly developed lymphatic drainage, such tissue is more prone to accumulation of fluid in the interstitium and thereby to edema. That's why usually the initial site where edema develops is around the eyes. If you like content, please press like and subscribe button. All the best!